مثل نوره كمشكات فيها مصباح المصباح في زجاجة الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة.
God is the light of the heavens and the earth. The parable of his light is as if there were a niche, and within the niche a lamp. The lamp enclosed in a glass, the glass a brilliant star, lit from a blessed tree, an olive, neither of the east nor of the west, whose oil is luminous, although untouched by fire. Light upon light.
نور على نور
In September 622, Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, proceeded from Makkah to Medina, where he led a life of poverty and resigned himself to God's will. Among his companions there were some who dwelt in a mosque, fasting and praying incessantly. They were called As-Sahab-e-Suffa, or people of the dais. The word Sufi, it is said, is derived from the term As-Sahab-e-Suffa. Others trace its origins to the word meaning purity. Still others say the word is too mystical to be derived from anything. Sufism, or Islamic mysticism, is not a philosophical system. It is spontaneous, experiential. God is pure being, the only real existence. He therefore includes all existence. He is also absolute good and absolute beauty, of which all earthly beauty is only a reflection. Man is separated from God by the illusion of self, and only by love can self be overcome. Only by love can man attain union with God. God is the true beloved. Saint Rabia of Basra in Iraq said, O God, if I worship thee in fear of hell, burn me in hell. And if I worship thee in hope of paradise, exclude me from paradise. But if I worship thee for thine own sake, then withhold not thine everlasting beauty. The way to God is marked by stages through which man must pass. The path or tariqa is arduous, and one needs a perfect guide, a peer. Only he can lead one through the various stages of the journey to God. One must therefore surrender totally to the peer.
اللهم طهر قلبي عن غيرك
اللهم طهر قلبي عن غيرك.
An important method of preparing the soul to receive love is zikr, that is, mystical invocation and repetition of the names of God. Early Sufis were lone experimenters, but soon silsilas or mystical orders were formed, so that the knowledge acquired by the masters could be handed down through the disciples. Each silsila differed from the other in some measure, both in principle and practice. Within each silsila, the disciple considered himself linked through his peer to the great saints of the past, to Hazrat Ali, to Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, and ultimately to God. Several silsilas have made their mark in India. Chishtiya, Suravardiya, Kupravia, Qadiriya and Naqshbandiya. Though the formula for zikr differs from one order to another, the practice of zikr is common to all silsilas. Indeed, the phonetic structure of zikr provides the basis for most Sufi experiments in sound and music. The mainstream of Sufi influence flowed into India from the northwest. Mansur Halaj, who in the 10th century paid with his life for his heretical cry, "I am the truth," was deeply influenced by his travels in Sindh. Sheikh Ali Hujwari, author of a well-known book on Sufism, settled at Lahore in the 11th century. Sheikh Moinuddin Chishti in the 13th century chose the land of Pushkar to live in. Thus, over the centuries, the whole of Sufi tradition was brought over from Iran, Khurasan, Turkestan. By the 11th century, the Sufis had developed meaningful contact with the Nathpanti yogis, followers of Gorakhnath. Al-Biruni translated Patanjali's Yoga Sutra into Arabic. He expounded on the parallels between Sufism on the one hand and the Bhagavad Gita on the other. Of all the Sufi silsilas that came into India, the Chishti order took root most immediately in the life of the common people. It spread rapidly across the country and has today become an exclusively Indian phenomenon. Hazrat Khaja Moinuddin Chishti, who settled down in Ajmer, laid down the basic tenets of the order: total poverty, refusal to own property, refusal to take up employment, rejection of all courtly patronage. Third in line of succession from Hazrat Moinuddin was Sheikh Nizamuddin, the greatest Indian Sufi of the 14th century. "Live among the people," he advised his disciples. "Bear all the hardships they inflict on you, but deal with them generously and courteously." Each Chishti saint dedicated his life to the welfare of a particular city or region. Their khanqahs or monasteries were open to all, including non-Muslims. Knowledge, food, work, everything was shared. They kept their distance from the palace. "When I see the king come in through one door," said Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia, "I go out of the other." The early sultans, unstable on their thrones, needed the support of the Sufi saints, who had contacts with people from all strata of society. The Mughal emperors, on the other hand, venerated the saints. Dara Shikoh, son of Emperor Shah Jahan, heir to the Mughal Empire, was a devout Sufi. He built this garden, Pari Mahal, that is the abode of fairies, in Srinagar, in honor of his Sufi guide. Dara Shikoh also translated the 55 Upanishads into Persian. He called them the secret of secrets. Jahanara Begum, daughter of the emperor, was initiated into Sufism and is buried next to the tomb of Hazrat Nizamuddin. Her epitaph reads, "Only the grass shall cover my grave, for grass suffices for the grave of such a pauper as I." What drew the Chishtis into the mainstream of Indian culture was their involvement with music as a medium of religious experience. Despite his distaste for political authority, the saint attended the king's court once to defend the use of music in mystical practice. For orthodox Muslim theology looks upon music with deep distrust. Hazrat Nizamuddin's involvement with music found expression in the life and works of his favorite disciple, Amir Khusro. Khusro was a master of two different musical systems, Persian and Indian, and produced a synthesis which became the foundation of Hindustani music. He is credited with the development of the Qawwali. Qawwali is mystical recitation. The object of sama, or listening to music and recitation, is to arouse mystical love, even ecstasy. From the 13th century on, Hindu mystical songs were used for sama at all Sufi centers. In this particular composition, Khusro set to music a saying in Arabic of Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, and added a section in Persian, which is zikr-like in its sound pattern. In Rag Shuddh Kalyan, the composition has remained unchanged in over 650 years and is given the pride of place at a summer conference. Qawwali is not entertainment, it is a spiritual exercise. Hence the presence of a sheikh is essential to guide the performance. Even the money paid to the performers is directed through the sheikh. A sama can so transport the listener that he often bursts into ecstatic dancing. Despite the aversion of the orthodoxy to music, every aspect of Indian music bears deep Muslim influence. Notice how the architecture of our folk musical instruments gradually develops Islamic motifs. This is true of musical instruments found in all corners of India. And the credit must go to the Sufis, particularly the Chishtis. The unmistakably Persian design of Indian fretted instruments is also attributed to the influence of Amir Khusro. The invention of the tarana, a musical form again phonetically related to zikr, is also credited to his genius. The close interweaving of music, Sufism, and yoga continued through the centuries. Tan Sen, the great singer in the court of Akbar, had for his peer a Shatari saint, Sheikh Muhammad Ghaus, who had studied Sanskrit and written a book on yoga. Kitab-e-Nauras, a treatise on Indian music written by Ibrahim Adil Shah II, Sultan of Bijapur, uses the language of Nathpanti yogis. Sufiana Kalam, as the name of this musical form suggests, was brought to Kashmir by the Sufis. Today the form has become identified with its land of adoption, while Iran, where it originated, has no trace of it. Legend has it that the Sufis of Kashmir permitted recourse to music in worship. For without music, the local people found devotion impossible. The shaping influence of the Sufis was not limited to music alone. It transformed regional languages in India, creating new literatures, and inspired poets like Kabir, whose works have molded the way we think and feel.
Mok kaha dhoonde re bande, main to tere paas mein, naam devar, naam masjid, na kaabe kailash mein. Mok kaha dhoonde re bande, main to tere paas mein.
Sadar daani din, sadar daani din, sadar tere